Not Just a Witch by Eva Ibbotson, read by Adjoa Andoh. When people quarrel, it's bad, but when witches quarrel, it is terrible. Heckie was an animal witch. Her full name was Hecate Tenbury Smith, and she had started when she was just a child, turning the boring noses of her mother's friends into interesting whiskery snouts, or covering the cold ears of traffic wardens with thick black fur. She was a kind girl and only wanted to be helpful, but when she gave the swimming bath attendant a fishy tail so that he could pretend to be a trout if he wanted to, her parents sent her away to a well-known school for witches. The motto the girls wore on their blazers said, "Witches against wickedness," and the headmistress was choosy about whom she took. Heckie was very happy there. Her best friend was a stone witch called Dora Maybury. When Dora was still in her high chair, she had looked at a raspberry jelly, and it turned into something you couldn't cut up, even with a carving knife. And when she started turning the toothpaste solid in its tube and filling the fridge with statues of pork chops, she too was sent away to school. It takes 30 years to train a witch, and during all that time, Heckie and Dora were friends. Heckie was tall and thin with frizzy hair, pop eyes and teeth which stuck out, giving her an eager look. Dora was squat and solid and had muscles like a footballer because it's heavy work dealing in stone. They shared their secrets and got each other out of scrapes, and at night in the dormitory they talked about how they were going to use their magic to make the world a better place. By this time, Heckie could change any person into whatever animal she pleased by touching him with her Knuckle of Power, though for the best results she liked to use her Toe of Transformation also, and Dora could turn anybody into stone by squinting at him out of her small round eyes. And then, when they had been friends for 30 years, Heckie and Dora quarrelled. It happened at the graduation party, where all the witches were to get their diplomas and go out into the world. The party, of course, was very special, and both Heckie and Dora went separately to the hat shop, kept by a milliner witch, and ordered hats. Obviously, a witch on the most important day of her life is not going to turn up in a straw hat trimmed with daisies or a bonnet threaded with sky blue lace. Heckie thought for a long time, and then she ordered a hat made of living snakes. The snakes were mixed. The crown of the hat was made of ribbon snakes, most delicately woven. Edging the brim were king snakes, striped in red and black, and a single black mamba, coiled in the shape of a bow, hung low over Heckie's forehead. Heckie tried it on, and it looked lovely. The snakes hissed and spat and shimmered. Snake hats are beautiful, and when you take them off, you just put them in a tank and feed them a few dead mice and a boiled egg or two, and they last for years. The day of the party came. Heckie put on her batskin robe, fixed a bunch of black whiskers onto her chin, and lowered the hat carefully onto her curls. She set off across the lawn to the tent where the refreshments were. But what should happen then? Coming towards her was her friend Dora, and she was wearing exactly the same hat. The same ribbon snakes were heaving and hissing on the crown. The same king snakes were writhing round the brim. The same poisonous mamba was tied into a bow. The two witches stopped dead and glared at each other. "How dare you copy my hat?" cried Heckie. "How dare you copy my hat?" Dora roared, sticking out her jaw. "I chose this hat first. I'm an animal witch. It's my right to wear a hat of living snakes." "Oh, really? I suppose you've heard of my great-great-great-grandmother who was a gorgon and had serpents growing from her scalp. It is my right to wear living snakes." But showing off about your relatives never works. Heckie only became angrier. "The only thing you've got a right to wear on your head is a bucket," she shrieked. Soon, the witches were throwing all sorts of insults at each other. From shouting at each other, the witches went on to tug at each other's hats. Dora tugged a ribbon snake out of Heckie's brim and hung it on a laurel bush. Heckie pulled at the end of Dora's black mamba and undid the bow. and all the time they screamed at each other as though they were spoilt little brats, not respectable middle-aged witches. 10 minutes later, both their hats were in ruins, and a friendship which had lasted all their school days was over. The witches had planned to go and live close together in the same town. They were each going to buy a business where they could earn their living like ordinary ladies, but all their spare time would be spent in doing good. Now, Heckie went by herself to the town of Wellbridge, but Dora went off to a different town. It was without her best friend, therefore, that Heckie began to try and make the world a better place. It was a boy called Daniel who found out that a witch had come to live in Wellbridge. He found out the night he went to babysit for Mr. and Mrs. Boothroyd at the Towers. Mr. Boothroyd owned a factory on the edge of the town which made bath plugs, and he was very rich. He was also very mean, and so was his wife. His baby, who was called Basil, was quite the most unpleasant baby you could imagine. Most babies have something about them which is all right, but Basil was an out-and-out disaster. When he wasn't screaming, he was kicking. When he wasn't kicking, he was throwing up his food. And when he wasn't doing that, he was holding his breath and turning blue. Daniel was really too young to babysit, and so was his friend Sumi. But Sumi, whose parents had come over from India to run a grocery shop, was so used to minding her three little brothers that the Boothroyds knew she would be fit to look after Basil while they went to have dinner with the Lord Mayor. What's more, they knew they would have to pay her much less than they would have to pay a grown-up. Sumi had suggested that Daniel came along. "I'll ask you your spellings," she said, because she knew how cross Daniel's parents got when he didn't do brilliantly at school. Daniel's parents were professors. His father was called Professor Trent, and if only Daniel had been dead and buried in some interesting tomb somewhere, the professor would have been delighted with him. He was an archaeologist who studied ancient tribes, and in particular their burial customs, and he was incredibly clever. But Daniel wasn't mummified or covered in clay, so the professor didn't have much time for him. Daniel's mother, who was also called Professor Trent, was a philosopher who had written no less than 7 books on the meaning of meaning, and she too was terribly clever, and found it hard to understand that her son was just an ordinary boy who sometimes got his sums wrong and liked to play football. The house they lived in was tall and grey and rather dismal, and looked out across the river to the university where both the professors worked. Often when Daniel came home from school, there was nobody there, just a note propped against the teapot telling him what to unfreeze for supper and not to forget to do his piano practice. When you know you're a disappointment to your parents, your school friends become very important. Fortunately, Daniel had plenty of these. There was Joe, whose father was a keeper in the Wellbridge Zoo, and Henry, whose mother worked as a chambermaid in the Queen's Hotel. And there was Sumi, who was so gentle and so clever. And because it was Sumi who asked him, Daniel went along to babysit at the Towers. The Boothroyds had been quite old when Basil was born, and they dressed him like babies were dressed years ago. He slept in a cot with a muslin canopy and blue bows. His pillow was edged with lace, and he had a silken quilt. And there he sat, in a long white nightdress, steaming away like a red and angry boil. The Boothroyds left. Sumi and Daniel settled down, and Sumi took out the list of spellings. "Separate," she said, and Daniel sighed. He was not very fond of separate. At that moment, Basil began to scream. By the time they got upstairs, he had turned an unpleasant shade of puce and was banging his head against the side of the cot. Sumi managed to gather him up. Daniel ran to warm his bottle. Sumi gave it to him, and he bit off the teat. Daniel ran to fetch another. Basil took a few windy gulps, then knocked the bottle out of Sumi's hand. It took a quarter of an hour to clean up the mess, and by the time they got downstairs again, Sumi had a long scratch across her cheek. "Separate," she said wearily, picking up the list. "S-E-P," began Daniel, and was wondering whether to try an A or an E, when Basil began again. This time, he'd been sick all over the pillow. Sumi fetched a clean pillowcase, and Basil took a deep breath and filled his nappy. She managed to change him, kicking and struggling, and put on a fresh one. Basil waited till it was properly fastened, squinted, and filled it again. It went on like this for the next hour. Sumi never lost her patience, but she was looking desperately tired, and Daniel could gladly have murdered Basil Boothroyd. At 8 o'clock, they gave up and left him. Basil went on screaming for a while, and then, miracle of miracles, he fell silent. When Daniel looked across at Sumi, he saw that she was lying back against the sofa cushions, fast asleep. Daniel should now have felt much better, and for about 10 minutes he did. Then he began to worry. Why was Basil so quiet? Had he choked? Had he bitten his tongue off and bled to death? Daniel crept upstairs and stood listening by the door. Basil wasn't dead. He was snoring. But he was snoring nicely. It was a cosy, snuffling snore. And it surprised Daniel because he didn't think that Basil could make any noise that wasn't horrid. Daniel took a few steps into the room and stopped dead. At first, he didn't believe it. What had happened was so absolutely wonderful that it couldn't be real. Daniel blinked and rubbed his eyes, but it was still there. Not a screaming, disagreeable baby, but the most enchanting bulldog puppy, with a flat, wet nose, a furrowed forehead, and a blob of a tail. The puppy opened its eyes, sat up, and wagged its tail. It licked Daniel's hands. "Oh, I do so like you," he said to the little wrinkled dog. And the dog liked Daniel. He jumped up to try and lick Daniel's face, but his legs were too short and he collapsed. Daniel had longed for a dog to keep him company. Now, it seemed like a miracle, finding this funny, loving, squashed-looking little dog in place of that horrible baby. Because Basil had gone. There was no doubt about it. Someone must have come in and taken Basil and put the little dog there instead. A kidnapper? But why leave the little dog? The Boothroyds might not be very bright, but they could tell the difference between their baby and a dog. I must go and tell Sumi, Daniel thought. And it was only then that he became frightened, seeing what was to come. The screaming parents, the police, the accusations. Perhaps they'd be sent to prison for not looking after Basil properly. And where was Basil? He might be an awful baby, but nobody wanted him harmed. Daniel tore himself away from the bulldog and studied the room. How could the kidnappers have got in? He walked over to the fireplace. It was the old-fashioned kind with a wide chimney. But even if the kidnappers had managed to come down it, how could they have got the baby off the roof? Then he caught sight of something spilled in the empty grate. A yellowish, coarse powder, like breadcrumbs. He scooped some up, felt it between his fingers, put it to his nose. Goldfish food! He knew, because the only pet his parents had allowed him to keep was a goldfish he'd won in a fair. And he knew, too, where the goldfish food came from. The corner pet shop, 2 streets away from his house. The shop had been sold a week ago to a queer-looking woman. Daniel had seen her. She'd been quite alone. Just the sort of woman who might snatch a baby to keep her company. He'd read about women like that taking babies from their prams while their mothers were inside a supermarket. The police usually caught them. They weren't so much evil as crazy. Daniel gave the puppy a last pat and went downstairs. Sumi was still asleep, one hand trailing over the side of the sofa. For a moment, he wondered whether to wake her. Then he let himself very quietly out of the house and began to run. He ran across the bridge, turned into Park Avenue where his house was, then plunged into the maze of small streets that led between the river and the marketplace. Close by, on a corner, was the pet shop. Daniel had been inside it often when the old man owned it, but now he stood in front of it, out of breath, and very frightened. It was dusk. The street lamps had just been lit, and he could see the notice above the door. "Under new management," it said. "Proprietor, Miss H. Tenbury Smith." The blinds were drawn, but upstairs he could see one lighted window. Daniel put his hand up to ring the bell, and dropped it again. If the woman in the shop had taken Basil, she was certainly not going to hand him over.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.